Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us again on this fourth webinar on questions and answers on machine learning. The format is the same as the last few weeks. We will first start with a small presentation, and then the floor is open for questions. If you already have a question, please do not hesitate to post it on the in the software. You can just type it in and we will answer it after the webinar. With me here in the panel are Hardeep and Arno. So let's get started. I would like to start this time with a small presentation on seismic object detection. And what I would like to discuss here is what is the difference between image-to-image type of workflows and image-to-point type of workflows? What is the difference between deep learning and shallow in this context? And I will then give a demo of how to create a salt cube in two different ways. One, using a shallow multi-layer perceptron, and secondly, with a deep Lunet type of convolutional neural network. Now, image-to-image workflows, the real challenge is here how to create your training set, because we need two data sets for this, at least two data sets. We need an input and a matching target. And the target can be a binary cube, so a cube with zeros and one, or a cube with binary numbers, 1, 2, 3, until n for seismic phases classifications, for instance. But it can also be a continuous cube, so with continuous variables. For instance, if we want to convert seismic cube into acoustic impedance or gamma ray or porosity or any value that is of interest. The workflow itself is as follows. We extract either 2D or 3D images from the input and the matching 2D or 3D images from the target cube. And then we pass these through a neural network, and that can be, for instance, a UNet. And then the UNet is trained to convert one image into the other. And as I said, the main challenge is how to create the training set. And this is also why most people who use this type of network are using synthetic seismic data. For example, our fault prediction network, which is a UNet fault predictor, has been trained on simulated 3D cubelets. And once the network has learned how to convert a 3D seismic volume into a 3D cube with zeros and ones, where zero is not a fault and one is a fault, you can apply this trained network to the real data, and the outcome is a fault prediction. And the result that I show here in the bottom is a thinned version of this. So after application of a thinning algorithm. Now, an image to point workflow is easier because we only need one input, and we also need examples of what this image represents. So the image again can be a 2D image or a 3D cubelet, and this is trained to recognize either a point which has a label. For instance, is this belonging to my chimney class or not to my chimney class? Or it is a continuous variable, a continuous value, like this seismic volume has to be transformed into acoustic impedance, for instance. Now, the point sets that you need for this is just a bunch of locations, and the locations have labels, in the case of a classification example, or they have a continuous value assigned to them, and that is for regression type of workflows. Now, this is much more easy than finding a matching target cube, an image, 2D or 3D, because I only need to interpret one point. In deep workflows, we pass the examples that are extracted around these locations through a deep learning graph, like a LANET convolutional neural network. And then the task is to either classify this or to predict the value of interest. The workflow is almost exactly the same for a shallow neural network, in this case a multi-layer perceptron. And I'll just walk you through how to create a chimney cube. So first we look at the seismic, and then we need to pick the locations that we then will label either as seismic chimneys or as not seismic chimneys. In this case, the green points are interpreted as seismic chimneys, and the blue points are the not chimneys. Now, the difference with the deep learning graph is that instead of extracting a 2D image or a cubelet around each sample position, is that we are extracting a set of attributes. And the attributes we have defined ourselves, and these attributes should at least be intelligent enough that they give us a kind of clue that this seismic response at a specific location is different from the seismic response that is not the class of interest. And therefore, you need to play with the attributes, but OpenDetect also comes with default attribute sets for various classification problems. Now, what you then do is you extracted all the picked manually interpreted positions, all the attributes the network needs to create your training set. And this training set is then split into a test set and a training set. And these are passed both through the network to find the relationship between seismic response and chimney or not chimney. And once you have trained the network, you can apply this, and you can either create a classification volume, so 0, 1 for chimney, not chimney, with a kind of confidence, or you can just output the value of the chimney prediction node, which is then giving you a kind of chimney probability output. And that's what is shown in this example. Now let me demo these two workflows in the new machine learning plugin. So we have here a data set from the Netherlands. It's offshore the Netherlands. And we see salt domes, and we're going to predict the salt domes. So what we need to do is we need to create example locations for this seismic object detection workflow in the salt, but also around the salt, so that we can distinguish between, is my seismic part of the chimney, or is it, the salt, or is it part of the normal seismic response? This can be done in OpenDetect in many different ways. And if we look at the new way of creating point sets, then you can, for instance, just randomly sample a certain range. You can extract along wells, you can extract within polygons, you can just extract along horizons, or between two horizons, but you can also do this in bodies. And that is how I created these point sets. So what I did is I created a body in here, and the body is just drawing on a line and then moving the line a number of positions and drawing another polygon, and then the body will be created automatically. So I created in this way two bodies here in purple for the salt, and two bodies around the salt representing the not salt type of seismic response. So that's on the flanks. Now, if you sample all the points within these bodies, then you will get way too many points. So what I did is I did some subsampling to create point sets that I could then use for training my neural networks. So these are the locations that I need for my neural networks. If I go to a shallow neural network, I need attributes. So my first step will be to go into the attribute set definition window, where I can create an attribute set that will be used for training the neural network. Now, you can either do this yourself, or you can take one of the default attribute sets, and there's a number of them, and one of them is called neural network salt cube. That's the one I used. If I import this one, it will ask me for what is the seismic data that you want to use, and what is the steering cube that you want to use. And then it imports all these attributes. Okay, the next step is to go to the neural network or machine learning control center. And then we're going to the old-fashioned shallow neural network first, and thereafter we're going to do seismic object detection with a deep learning network. So we're going to train a shallow neural network on these locations. So that is a form of pattern recognition. And here you see the user interface ask me for which of these attributes do I want to use. That has pre-selected all of them, so I will use all of these. And I can also select any of the stored volumes. This is a supervised data set, and I would then create the two point sets, or pick up the two point sets, and I would split this into a training and test set. 20% will in this case be set aside for validating, testing the neural network. Now, if I would now press OK, that would take a lot of time just to extract all these points, all these attributes at all these points, because I have in my bodies 50,000 points, 2 times 25,000 approximately. So I'm going to retrieve these attributes that have already been extracted. Here they are. I'm going to use all of them, and I'm going to train them on flanks or salts. 20% for training. I'm pressing OK. It then comes with this spreadsheet where I can do some cross plotting and other validations. But in this case, I will just press run to start the neural network training. And this is relatively a fast process. You see two curves. At the moment, these curves are overlapping, a red and a blue curve, which is the normalized RMS error that is going down as the network learns the relationship. And we also see the percentage misclassification. You can see that it's quite nicely behaving. I can predict almost all my examples properly. You also see in this network the input attributes, and the input attributes are color-coded from white to red, and the red node indicates that this is the most important attribute for this classification problem. So most of the weights are attached to this dip attribute. I can use this color scheme to check out a number of attributes that are not really important for this classification, so I can tune my network in this respect. Now, once the curves flatten off, I can pause this. I won't, well, let me just save it, TMP, and press OK. And I have an info button here for this network. You can see that it has produced quite some good results, which I can also display on the test data set. These are the good classifications, predicted class versus the actual class, and only a very small portion is misclassified. You also see that this network has all these inputs. These are my attributes, and it has four potential outputs. I can output a classification and a confidence. I can output what is the output of the flank attribute or the salt attribute. And if I would just do this one, output the salt points, then I'm getting a kind of salt probability output. Now, to actually apply this neural network, I can either do it on the fly as with all attributes, but I can also create a seismic output volume. Then I go to processing attributes, single attribute 3D, and I would select the output that I want from my neural network, salt points, and then I would press OK, and I would create some kind of salt cube. Now I can do that on a single processor, or I can do a distributed computing if I have more computers available to me. Now that is one workflow, and that would create something like this applied to my seismic line. So this shows me where I have high probability of salt versus no salt. That is with a shallow neural network. Let's now do the deep learning workflow. That starts from here. It's a seismic body supervised workflow. I think the workflow is a bit simpler because it is all within the new user interface, with an input that you create, a training tab and an application tab, so you don't have to go and find the menus that you have to use. You start with extracting data, and basically you just pick up the two points, and you can call them not salt and salt, and these are the point sets, and you can see how many data points I do have in each of these classes, more than 25,000, which is a lot, but that is also what you need in deep learning, because the networks are so much bigger, you need to have more examples to train it. Okay, I press proceed. And it will ask me from which data set or data sets. I can extract from multiple data sets. In this case, I will just extract from the seismic itself. And then I can specify the image that I want to extract. Now, I tried it with a 3D image, 8x8x8, but I didn't like that result, so I then referred it back to a 2D image. It's just 0 in the inline direction, 12 in the crossline direction, and 12 in the Z direction. And then you give it an output name, and it will be your training example data set. I'm not going to do this because this will also take time. So instead of going to proceed here, I'm going to train, picking up the trained training set, the ML salt 0, 12, 12. Can give it some kind of name here. And I now see that my user interface is not starting up. So I'm going to restart my server. And because this is a separate process, it's the link between our C++ environment and the Python environment. And there we are. So this is a deep learning Keras type of image to point neural network. I can set the parameters. The network is a LNET type of classifier. And basically, I don't have to do much on these. And then I can press run. I'll just run it for a few cycles to see what happens, and then we can abort it. If all goes well, it should also start up my my TensorBoard application, where I can see the progress of the training itself. And here I can follow in these log files also the actual progress of the training. There it starts a TensorBoard. This is my previous run. And it should now add a next run. If this thing gets any further than this. Oh yeah, it's starting up now. Yeah. So this is the progress that you can see, and you can see the loss and the accuracy printed in different cycles, epochs during the training. And that same information is also displayed at some point when we have a little bit further in these type of graphs. Okay, I will close this now because we do have a trained neural network aboard it. And then the next step is just to apply it. We have the project, we have the trained neural network. We press proceed. And then it's just a question of applying it. And if I would apply it in the entire volume, it would take a lot of time. So I saved a certain range, a small subvolume around my salt domes. And in that range, I output only the salt classification result, which is giving me a salt probability type of output, very similar to my shallow neural network. Now, I already did this, so we can compare the deep learning result with the shallow neural network result, and the deep learning network looks like this. And I think that is a much neater, better result because it's much closer follows the actual outline as I would have interpreted this body myself as compared to this. And here we see the LNET in the small subvolume where I processed it. And that is the outline of the body as detected by the two salt bodies, actually, as detected by the deep learning network. And that concludes this presentation. So I would like now to start with the question and answers session.